Now have a session, a fireside chat with Shraddha Joshi and Soni Bhattacharya, grassroots experiences from leaders of civil society organizations. Quickly introducing the both of you, Shraddha leads Marvin's efforts in financial inclusion, livelihoods development, and grassroots institutional building. She started her career with the civil services in 2005 as the deputy collector of Nainital, where she developed a passion for women's issues, which ultimately motivated her decision to take stewardship of Mavim in 2018. Her work has taken her to all corners of Maharashtra with postings in Nagpur, Chandrapur, Nanned, Kolhapur, and Mumbai. Soni is an intrepid entrepreneur and social change enthusiast who has 30 plus years of experience in the development sector. Currently, she is CEO at Breakthrough, an organization working in India using multimedia, popular culture, leadership development, and community mobilization strategies to transform gender norms that perpetuate violence against women. Soni serves on the board of Dastkar, Kolkata Sanved, and Akar Social Associates, and is a trustee of Read India, an organization creating community-led sustainable libraries in rural India. It is great to have the both of you, and I will now hide myself and let you take the conversation forward. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much, Seerat, for having us over here on this nice platform, discussing a nice topic.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Seerat. And Shraddha, thank you so much. You know, lovely to be here on this with you. I think we could start a little bit with your story. How did you land up in this sector? How did you come to work with Mavim? A little bit of that, and then I can do the same.
Yeah, sure, Shoini, and nice to be with you on this panel. Actually, I would say I'm passionate about this subject. Daily we see, whether at our workplaces or our societies, so many issues we all are facing. We are seeing so many issues. And maybe instead of talking about my journey, I would love to talk about my organization's journey. How are we doing this work, and how have we initiated? So Mavim is Women Development Corporation for the state of Maharashtra. And we started with the goal of attaining women empowerment. We wanted to go towards attaining the goal of 100% women empowerment, 360 degree empowerment. And we thought we should start with economic empowerment as the first step. But as soon as we started, we realized that our economy has set some of the notions, and they are running with some of the notions. And very prime notion was that a poor person, they cannot save. They are not capable of borrowing, and even if they borrow, they cannot repay. So first problem we faced was we had a combination of poor and women both. So it becomes a lethal combination, because the moment she wanted to start some income generation activity or business activity, she needed some kind of monetary help, loan, credit from the banking sector or other formal credit system. But she was never part of this banking system. So we thought we should create some kind of credit history for them. That is how we started working with self-help groups. And these self-help groups, they started saving. Then some kind of credit history was created. And based on this credit history, then the formal banking system started giving loans to them. And I'm very proud that if you see today, so our loan size is around 4,600 crores. And repayment rate is 98% to 99%. And in this era, when NPAs have become a buzzword, so big shots even are not able to repay bank loans. In this scenario, our women, I'm talking about these 17 lakh women, credit size of 4,600 crores, and NPAs are just 0.5 to 0.8%. Repayment rate is 99%. So that is how they are actually growing in their journey, doing very nice activities. And we are trying to do our bit towards women empowerment. Now, I would love to hear your story. How have you landed into this field, and how has been your journey?
Thank you, Shraddha. That was really fabulous. And the NPA is, you know, that's fabulous. I have a little bit of experience of working in microfinance. So the early part of my journey, when we tried to kind of set up, you know, women's groups in rural West Bengal on the same issue. One of the things that I've always experienced is that having a livelihood and having access to money doesn't always translate for you know, women's agency or even their ability to actually fight violence. And that's why, you know, I actually landed up in Breakthrough about 11 years ago, and I really loved the way Breakthrough actually talks about gender norm change, you know, which is a root change, you know, a root change in the roots of, you know, everything, so that women and girls can actually reach their full potential. One of the ways we do this is actually using a lot of media, you know, because we believe that when issues like violence against women and girls and other kind of really serious issues are presented to people in a much more with a lot of, you know, entertainment and in a much more in a way that you can actually make them your own issues, you know. It doesn't then feel that, you know, all of this is very far away from you and that you cannot really comment on that. So that's how Breakthrough started its journey, with music videos and campaigns on violence against women. And then, you know, about 10 years ago, about eight, nine years ago, we found out that, you know, as women kind of try to battle and combat, gender-based violence and domestic violence, it becomes very clear that women who are married very early, you know, in their 12s and 13s and 14s, they are least occupied, you know, to actually handle this kind of things. In fact, there is research that says that gender-based violence goes up by 40%, domestic violence goes up by 40% if you're married off as a young girl. So we thought, you know, why not work with young girls as well as young boys, trying to actually build a gender equitable viewpoint from young age. So at the center of our work now is a gender equity curriculum called Taro Ki Toli, which builds gender equitable viewpoints, gives young girls and boys negotiation skills, gives them life skills, and teaches them to have difficult conversation on taboo subjects, not only with their peers, which is important, but also with their parents, you know. And this happens only across rural areas. So we work across 5 states with about 500,000 adolescents, and we work across government schools as well as communities with this curriculum. Lately, with the partnership with the Education Department of Punjab government, we've scaled this up across 4,500 schools, government schools in Punjab. And we're hoping to train, you know, master trainers who finally reach out to 20,000 government school trainers in Punjab. And this is what we'd love actually to scale up across India, because we believe that to start talking to young people whose views are still malleable and, you know, those hard to shift norms are still questionable, and there's curiosity to question that, then over the period of time, you would be building up really empowered young people who can reach their potential in whatever way they want to choose. So that's what that's what we work on.
Great, wonderful to hear that.
And I would love to Thank you. I'd love to actually know a little bit about, do you in any way involve men and boys in the work that you do, Shraddha?
Yes, definitely. And a very relevant question, because it is a fact that women can't fight against men. It is not a fight against one or the other. Both complement each other, and when they both work together, both work in synergies, then only this problem could be resolved. So what we do in our organization, we have created, we call it Mavim Mitra Mandal. So in our villages, we see for some good progressive men. It's a smart strategy also, you can say, because we take along progressive men, and we make a group of those progressive men. We take them along, we give them trainings also, some kind of session. I should not say training, because then it becomes a little heavy. So in a lighter way, we take them along, we teach them about the issues, we sensitize them about gender issues, and whenever we want to start some kind of action, as you spoke about domestic violence, and as we all have seen during COVID also, so many instances have increased, actually numbers have increased, either domestic violence or child abuse, such issues have increased in this period. So we take these kind of men along, we create group of those men, and then whenever we want to talk about domestic violence or the rights of women, especially like we have worked towards property rights, equal property rights we are working for, I also feel that that is a very, very important factor. And men, they'll give everything, they will say that I'll protect you, I am there for you and everything is there, but when it comes to property, it becomes very, very difficult. And legally equal rights are available, but practically they are not. So we have taken these men along and we have worked a lot towards such issues, whether it is domestic violence or joint ownership or girl child celebration, such things, so that overall scenario, psyche of the society or perception of the society changes towards this. Do you also, like you also spoke about it, so do you also the youth or men?
Yes, you know, we've actually worked with men and boys for a long time, you know, and especially you know, even when a lot of organizations were not really talking about men and boys. So one of the campaigns that we did in 2008 was called Bel Bajao, where we asked men and boys to stand up and take action against domestic violence through a simple action like ringing the bell. And believe you me, we had huge, you know, responses from men across the world when we did that. One of the things that we have since then done is that because we work in gender norm change, it becomes very imperative for us to engage with, you know, nuances around the barriers, you know, particularly violence and discrimination, which women face all the time, you know. One of the things we've seen when we have, you know, we worked on a project across two factories, you know, with working women, women who work outside their homes. Now, we saw that even in the families where the women go out to work, that going out to work is not always respected. Yeah, and we believe that that is viewed with suspicion. You know, I mean, we've often had men ask questions like, you know, why are you taking the same auto to the work, to your workspace every day? You must be having some scene with the autowala. And the woman is doing it because of the convenience, you know, that kind of gives that. So two things. One is that safety in public spaces for women is very important. As you know, if you, women are going to banks or they're going to their, you know, Mitra Mandals, then it becomes very difficult for them to go out if there's no safety in public spaces. This remains an alarming concern with women's mobility and all of that. And the other thing is to create a workplace environment that discourages violence against women. And again, men is important for that because, you know, with both men and women, we can actually create those safety nets that they can fall back upon if there's any incident at the workplace. And we believe that actually, after all, it's the home where it all starts. So if you have a safe space at home, you have respect at home, you have control over your money, and people are sharing the housework that you are doing, then you are creating a conducive atmosphere at home for a woman to actually go out and start also exploring, you know, what other things that she can do outside. So men and boys, the whole behavior around this mindset that the masculinity is giving you freedom to behave the way you want to, you know, and that women should take care of domestic chores and children and money, and so that what they're earning cannot be also controlled by them, you know, because women do not know anything about money, right? You know, so this all spills over in public spaces, where the belief is that the women is inviting harassment through their dressing, through their behavior, through their mobility of being outside at night, you know. So what we do is that from a young age, we start talking about these things, you know, talking about whether you'd want to share household chores or not, you know, whether you'd like to have a partner who works, you know, outside of the home. And what we've seen in our work is that boys are very willing at the end of the program to actually talk about sharing housework, you know, and talk about how we have had boys who have stood up to against sexual harassment their classmates were, you know, facing on their way to school, or they have stood up and said, you know, ये घर का काम है, ये मुझे भी करना है, you know. So we are seeing those changes very slowly, but we are seeing those changes, and we believe that if we introduce this kind of things at a very early age, then we can build actually a community response, because we all know that, you know, women bear the lion's share of household chores, and young girls also, and sometimes they have to drop off school because of that. So if we can begin from the home itself, then, you know, all of these things over a period of time becomes normalized. Right now, as violence is normalized, you know, over a period of time, women doing things on their own, women taking decisions on their own, women working outside of the home will become normalized. You know, that's the hope that we work on.
Yeah, very true. And I also feel, I also have such experiences as you were discussing. So I was also remembering that when we recruit people, so I always feel that boys are so very confident, whether their qualification matches the job role or not, they'll be very confident and they'll always say, yes, I'll be able to do it. But when a girl comes for an interview, so if the bio data matches 100% with the job role, then she'll be confident. Then also her confidence doesn't match the confidence of a boy. But if even if some percentage is matching is not there, then she'll be a little bit hesitant and she'll not say with full conviction that yes, I'll do it. So sometimes I feel whether the boys are born with this kind of quality or they are brought up like this. So I always also feel, as you said, that it is the how we bring them up actually. We make our boys so very confident. From the very starting, we give them responsibilities. They roam around freely. But when it comes to our girls, we actually want them to be polite, to adjust, to always smile. So rules should be flexible, and they should not, women should not adjust actually. So a scenario becomes like this, as you said, this is very right, that from the very starting point, gender parity should come as a norm. Then only it could happen. And I also feel that there are so many contradictions. If we see a woman's life, then there are so many contradictions. We call her ghar ki malkin, har cheez ki malkin. But when you talk about ownership, then even if world scenario, if you see less than 20% ownership is with women, India scenario is worse than this. Then her work, if we see, then mostly unpaid work she does. So we can give good number of amount to either Swiggy's or Zomato's or Urban Clubs or any such agency, but the work when she does, it remains unpaid. It's not about the payment. I'm not talking about the monetary equivalence of that, but acknowledgement of her work becomes very, very important. Like I see in the farming sector, so much of work is being done by women. If I ask anyone to imagine about a farmer, to close eyes and just think about a farmer, so first thing comes to our mind is a man with a kurta pajama and having a equipment in his hand. We never can think of a woman in a farmer's role. So even if she's doing, he's taking huge responsibility of that work, but acknowledgement as farmer, we never ever give her that acknowledgement. So that is a big, big problem. So much of contradiction is there in her life. So actually, whatever we say, that should translate in reality. Empowerment, even if we are starting with economic empowerment, should translate into social, political, all sectors actually.
You're so right, you know, Shraddha, one of the things that we have seen in Indian schools, you know, our schools are also very inherently patriarchal spaces, because, you know, you are automatically assuming that girls should be taught to be docile and quiet and should not have too many ambitions and things like that. boys can go out and play and be their boisterous self. Girls shouldn't laugh. You know, I used to whistle as a young girl, and my mother always told me, you know, girls shouldn't be whistling. And I said, why can't girls whistle? You know, girls should be sitting at a higher place and, you know, swing their legs. That's a very, you know, bad thing to do. Now, 50 years ago, but I don't see it changing 50 years hence. You know, girls should be bound at home, girls should share in household chores, girls should be bringing up the siblings, while the boys can go and hang out and play with their friends. One of the things that we have seen is the leisure time for girls. And, you know, we've just completed a study of one of our programs in UP, you know, across six districts. And there, you know, both girls and boys have negotiated for leisure time for girls. So the demand for leisure time for girls have gone up, both from girls as well as boys, because there is hardly any leisure time for girls. You know, girls get up in the morning, study or whatever, help their parents in domestic chores, goes off to school, comes back from school, does again, you know, household work. And there is research that I think 63%, you know, number of girls are actually involved in so much of housework that they often kind of drop out of school. And world over, women do three times more housework than men. And as you were saying, you know, it's not about payment, but it's about recognizing this work as work, recognizing agricultural labor, women agricultural labor who work in the fields as work. That's the perception has to move in people's mind that we are seeing this work and that girls can do anything and everything. Also, during COVID, it's gotten worse because, you know, girls were at home, women were at home, children were at home, migrant laborers, you know, husbands who were probably migrant laborers were back home. So, you know, you didn't even have the freedom to do whatever you wanted when the husband was away. And number of domestic chores increased, you know. We've just done a survey where it says that if a woman falls sick in a household, then the job actually goes to the next girl in line. So it will go first to all the girls in the house, and then it will go to the boys and the men if all the girls fall sick. See, there's a hierarchy of domestic chores. In this 21st century, what are we talking about? And then also, we feel that whenever boys want to share housework, माँ क्या बोलती है, मेरी राजा बेटा है, देखो कितना काम करता है. So that also then becomes very difficult to deal with. You know, men can share housework. There's no need to kind of really lodge them about it because it's a normal thing for them to do. So I think all of these issues are actually very difficult to kind of traverse, but we have to kind of talk to them. I don't know, and so it starts from the classrooms, you know, where girls should be taught STEM education. You know, girls should be taught about maths. I'm sure in your, you know, in your women's groups, they have the hisab at their fingertips, right? They know everything about how much money they have saved. You know, so who says that girls can't do hisab or girls can't do maths? You know, so I think those things need to change from the school and the home itself.
Exactly. And just to take from your thing, like as you said, माँ बोलती है राजा बेटा है करता है, एंड सेम वेज इफ यू टॉक अबाउट द मेन नो हू फील दैट दे आर वेरी वेरी प्रोग्रेसिव. सो व्हाट दे विल से, मैंने अपने वाइफ को अलाउ किया, शी इज एन एमबीए, शी इज अ डॉक्टर एमबीबीएस, एंड देन हु आर यू टू अलाउ. एक्चुअली दे फील सो प्राउड कि नहीं, मैं रोकता नहीं हूँ और मैं अलाउ करता हूँ. तो is as you were saying, that has hit our psyche badly actually, so that has to be changed. And what has happened, like in our self-help groups, so sometimes I feel that, as you said, the me time. So even when women are coming for self-help group meetings, it becomes a very important time for them. It helps them grow because they talk to each other, they share their grievances, their happiness, everything they share with each other. And I'll just give you one example. A few days ago, I was talking to our women. So I was asking them, अभी आप जब से इसमें आते हैं, बचतगढ़ के सेल्फ हेल्प ग्रुप के मीटिंग्स में आते हैं, तो क्या चेंज आपने देखा है? सो वन ऑफ द वुमन शी स्टूड एंड शी सेड कि मैडम, पहले जब मैं बचतगढ़ की मीटिंग में आती थी तो पहले मैं पूछ के आती थी, अब मैं बता के आती हूँ. So this kind of change, so this is not a mere statement. There is a huge lot difference when she says that पूछ के आने से बता के आने तक का डिफरेंस जो है, इट मेक्स अ ह्यूज ह्यूज डिफरेंस. दैट मींस केवल जीना, केवल लाइफ काट नहीं रही है अभी. नाउ शी हैज स्टार्टेड लिविंग हर ओन लाइफ. नाउ शी इज देयर टू राइट हर ओन स्टोरी. शी हैज द राइट ऑफ राइटिंग हर ओन स्टोरी. एंड नाउ शी इज एबल टू टेक डिसीजंस इन हर लाइफ, वेदर इट इज हर किड्स एजुकेशन और गर्ल्स गर्ल चाइल्ड्स मैरिज एज और दीस काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स. सो समथिंग शी हैज अटेन्ड. So that power, that agency in the household is very, very important. And when it comes to a woman, as I said, we have worked a lot towards equal property rights also. We don't say that transfer the rights to women. We try to give joint titling in the property papers. So when it happens, the whole scenario changes, the perception of the society towards a lady, these kind of things change. And then when we are creating such examples where we say that a woman who has not taken her own property right, she's a very good lady, or who smiles, or who's docile, or who is adjusting, we set such examples. So now it has to be changed. And sometimes it badly affects poor women actually. Somehow some people who can afford, even when they are not claiming their rights, they are setting such examples. So what we do in our organization, we say that you first ask for it, and if you don't want, then you can do anything from that property also, but start doing that so that the whole society's norm changes. So you said something about your
Shraddha, that is really very interesting to hear. And you know, I mean, one of the points I'd like to make here is that we have to look at all of this in a much more deeper intersectional way, in the sense that in our country, of course, caste is a huge intersection with gender, and we've seen, you know, violence against caste-based violence has not reduced, you know, it has gone up only, and we see a lot of manifestations of that. And though there are,
and you know, even after Olympics, we are seeing so much of this issue.
So much
this
of that, you know. So that's the other. The other issue is, you know, women, trans women, or even, you know, when you're talking about LGBTQI, you know, both, you know, men, women, and you know, other genders. So those are even more difficult to actually then, you know, those intersections are even more difficult to then, you know, move, because while, you know, I was hearing the session just before our session, and they're talking about the law has changed. The law has changed, but the norm has not, you know, the behavior has not. And so there is an opportunity here to include other people, other genders, you know, into this whole conversation. And we keep, I know, I mean, one of the questions that I often ask is that, and I often ask this of the people who work at the very, our community developers who really work with the community, is that, do we, you know, how do we then deal with these things in the villages? Because even in urban settings, it's very difficult to deal with. How do we deal with these kind of things in the urban areas? So all of these intersections have to be kept in mind when norm change is happening. So are we changing norms about, you know, about boys and girls, all boys and all girls, you know, all women and all men, or are we just kind of keeping ourselves to the binary? Because this, you know, this is 2021, you can no longer talk about binaries in that, you know, you have to open it up to the whole thing. So those are also difficult issues to deal with when you're trying to work within that norm change thing. But as you say, you know, as I also, I was just talking in a panel a couple of weeks ago, and I said this whole thing about girls and women, and maybe all girls and women are like paraya dhan. This is something that has to actually change, and it's still there in people's minds, you know. So all our education system, everything is actually, and especially in rural areas too, and in many urban areas also, it's connected to marriage. So, you know, everything that you do in your life as a young girl, you know, is connected to, you will get married, and then that will be the be all and end all of all your, you know, dreams and ambitions and everything. How do you deal with this? You know, how do you really traverse that? Because your higher education is connected to marriage. Your being good in studies is being connected to marriage. So I think there is a point where you have to start breaking these, and then probably we will get some more ideas and some more, you know, ways of looking forward. And then things like property, like women are saying, hey, apni property apni brother ko de diya, you know, very nice, you know. So she's giving it away. Why should she give it away? She's doing it under coercion, you know. So I think we have to really break these few things. We have to make schools much more gender oriented. We have to make education much more gender oriented. We have to stop relating everything to marriage. And also, you know, things like information about financial literacy. Why can't we start at the school level? You know, why can't girls have information on career opportunities, and financial opportunities, entrepreneurial opportunities from a school level? All of these, you know, the RCIs and things that the government is running, you know, for women. I believe there are many of these vocational training centers being set up only for women. Why can't we also look at things for women to do, which is not bunai, silai, you know, papad and achar, you know? So we have to look at all of those things. So that's where I'll stop. And if there's anything that you want to kind of, you know, wrap up.
Just to add to this, like we are doing two kinds of things. Like one is the traditional sector where women are working, and one is the non-traditional sector. They also, we are working very hard. Like we'll be initiating one petrol pump which will be run by women only, then two-wheeler service center or electrician or these kind of professions where we don't feel that women are able to do so. I think Seerat is there. She wants to say that time is over. So Seerat.
I'm really sorry to interrupt the both of you, but thank you so much. It was so inspiring to learn about the work that both of you do, especially around intentionally bringing in boys and men. I think gender stereotypes are very entrenched, so it was great to hear about the work that you're doing. And thank you so much for coming and speaking about it. I'm sure I was truly inspired. I'm sure everybody else was as well.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Shraddha. It was lovely to, you know.
Yeah, thank you, Shwini.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Our next panel, the gender track for today is over, but we have a plenary called Emerging Role of Science and Technology in India's Growth. We would love for you to head over there. But before you do that, we want to quickly share the plan for tomorrow for the gender track. Our session starts at 10:15 a.m. Our session starts at 10:15 a.m. and the first session we have is Shaking Up Social Spaces. We have some really exciting and influential folks here who will speak about their experiences in social media, theater, movies, etc. So see you all tomorrow, and do head to the plenary that's starting right about now. Thank you.